Hello everybody, welcome to this video on the receptive field of convolutional neural networks. In the following video, you will see how the concept of the receptive field is crucial to understanding how convolutional neural networks process images. Initially, each layer of a CNN focuses on small sections of the image, but as we add more layers, this area expands, allowing the network to capture broader patterns and details. We can use specific formulas to precisely calculate this area, which we call theoretical receptive field. However, this theoretical receptive field is not always fully exploited by the network. In practice, CNNs rely more on the central pixels of this area, leading to the concept of the effective receptive field. This difference is influenced by factors such as the network architecture or the weight initialization, but also the training process. Understanding both the theoretical and effective receptive fields is essential when using CNNs to get the most out of them. Let's start with the basics. What is this thing that we call receptive field? When you look at an image, you see all the pixels at once. You can perceive the overall shape, like the outline of this digit, as well as the fine details. But what does a convolutional filter see? A filter sees the image through a small window, focusing on just a tiny portion at a time. A convolutional network is made up of many filters, each one looking at the image through its own small window. The maximum area that the convolutional network can capture and process, considering all these windows, is known as the receptive field. Let's see how to compute it for any given network. Let's say we have a simple convolutional neural network with three layers, each with a 3x3 filter and a stride of 1. In the first layer, the filter sees only through a 3x3 window. It then produces a feature map of the same dimension as the image. The second layer sees this feature map through its own 3x3 window. But does it only see the direct 3x3 area from the input image? Not quite. The pixels in this window are influenced by their surrounding pixels in the original image. The information used by the second layer is spread over a slightly larger area than you might think. Now, what happens in the third layer? This layer works on the feature map produced by the second layer, and it again sees a 3x3 window of this feature map. Here, each pixel is computed from the surrounding pixels of the previous feature map, which in turn were influenced by their surroundings in the original image. In essence, by the time we reach the third layer, it has access to a much larger portion of the original image, specifically a 7x7 window. It means that the receptive field of the network increases with each convolutional layer. We can precisely calculate how the receptive field of a network increases after each convolutional layer by considering the parameters of these layers. We will now see how to derive an explicit formula for calculating the receptive field of a convolutional network. For simplicity, we will use 1D convolutions, which work in a similar way to 2D convolutions, but in a single direction. Consider an example with one input named F0 and two convolutional layers output named F1 and F2. We will denote the kernel sizes as K1 and K2 and the strides as S1 and S2. Remember, the stride is the number of pixels the kernel moves at each step. And finally, we will define the receptive field for each layer. It is the number of features in a layer needed to compute one final feature. For instance, we can quickly notice that the second layer takes three features from F1 to compute one final feature in F2. It means that the receptive field of the last layer is equal to K2, so R2 is equal to 3. We can now compute the receptive field of the first layer using the following formula. Let's assume the stride of the first layer is equal to 1 and its kernel size is equal to 3. By replacing the variables in the formula with their values, we see that we expect a receptive field of 5. And we can see by sliding the kernel around that we indeed need 5 features from F0 to compute one final feature in F2. Now assume the stride of the first layer is equal to 2. Again, if we replace the variables in the formula, we see that we expected a receptive field of 7. And we see that we indeed need 7 features from F0 to compute one final feature in F2. This formula can be applied to any layer in a convolutional network to compute the receptive field of that layer. But what if we want to compute the receptive field of the network without iterating through each layer? In fact, this formula admits a closed-form solution. This allows us to compute the receptive field of the network directly, based only on the parameters of its layers. Let's see a complete example now. We can consider again our simple architecture with three convolutional layers. We use standard parameters for each layer, 3x3 filters and a step of 1. As you can see, adding a layer increases the receptive field by 1 pixel in each direction. In fact, in this case, the formula that gives us the receptive field of the network simplifies to 2 times the number of layers plus 1. So if we want to detect a digit that is about 15 pixels wide, we need at least 7 layers for the network to see it entirely. Now imagine that we want to work with high-quality images rather than this small digit example. In this picture, the dog is at least several hundred pixels wide. So if we wanted to detect it based on its global shape, we would need at least 100 layers in the network. Fortunately, there is a way to increase the size of the receptive field much faster, and that is by using pooling layers. A pooling layer is a special convolutional layer that usually has a 2x2 max filter and a stride of 2. If we look at our general formula for calculating the receptive field, we see that we multiply each term in the sum by the product of the strides of each layer. So since pooling layers have a stride of 2, the formula simplifies to 2 to the power of p, with p being the number of pooling layers. This means that if we have a pooling layer in a network, we immediately multiply its receptive field by 2. This also means that the receptive field grows exponentially with the number of pooling layers in the network. We can build a simple CNN with 3 convolutional layers and 3 pooling layers to see how the receptive field grows. As you can see now, the receptive field grows much faster as we pass through the layers of the network, and with 3 layers, we can already detect any digit in this example. With our previous example of the dog image, we needed more than 100 layers to detect the dog. If we add a pooling layer after each convolution layer, we can now work with less than 10 layers and easily detect the dog in this image. For now, we have only considered the theoretical receptive field, which is the maximum number of pixels that will influence the calculation of a feature. But as the name suggests, the theoretical receptive field is only a theoretical maximum. Do convolutional neural networks really take all this information into account in practice? Well, actually, no, far from it. As we will see, not every pixel in the receptive field has the same importance to the CNN, with pixels becoming less important as we move away from the center of the receptive field. The pixels that are actually considered by the network are what is commonly referred to as the effective receptive field of the network. We can actually measure the effective receptive field of a convolutional network. We start by setting a specific output feature of the network to 1. Then, by backpropagating the gradients, as we do during training, we can determine the contribution of each feature to that output. We then repeat the process until we reach the input layer, which gives us the contribution of each input pixel, which is the effective receptive field. In this example, we are using a network with 15 layers composed of simple 3x3 convolutions, which is supposed to have a receptive field of 31 pixels. However, when we observe the effective receptive field, it is significantly smaller, around 20 pixels. The information on the exterior of the receptive field is lost as we go deeper in the network, while the information at the center is preserved. You can also see that the receptive field is not completely symmetrical and has some gaps. This is due to the weights of the network being randomly initialized. If we set every weight to the same value, you can notice that the effective receptive field becomes smoother and symmetrical. For this example, we took a network with random weights, but training can actually also change the effective receptive field. In this example, we take the famous Lennet 5 architecture, developed by Jan LeCun in 1998 for handwritten digit recognition. To visualize its receptive field, we discard the fully connected head and keep only the convolutional layers, then set an output feature to 1 and backpropagate it as we did before. When untrained, the effective receptive field follows a rough Gaussian shape with some gaps. When we then train the network, it seems to focus on certain parts of the receptive field and discard others completely, whereas as humans we might think that every pixel could potentially be useful. As training progresses, the shape of the receptive field stops changing, but some gaps are still clearly visible, and the overall area appears smaller than without training. The simple network performs much better than humans at digit classification, with a top 1 accuracy of around 98.6%. proving that not all pixels in the image are really useful for this task. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, please like and subscribe to help me grow the channel. See you in the next video.